What's maybe the most bizarre thing that you've been given for a tattoo?
I mean, the offers are incredible. like Snoop Dogg's weed, amazing.
Actual Snoop Dogg's weed?
Yeah.
Great.
Stanislava Pinchuk, or Miso, is an artist and highly coveted tattooist who migrated from Ukraine to Australia as a child. Her work has appeared everywhere from the Australian National Gallery to big brands like Chanel and on the skin of rock stars. But the 29-year-old actually spends a lot of her time in disaster zones to create art like this.
I've been tattooing for about 8 years now. Yeah, I don't know, it's just hanging around with a lot of punks that were doing home jobs. Instead of putting a needle into a machine, I just hand poke it. Which is, I guess, the way people have tattooed for, you know, thousands and thousands of years.
And you've never taken any money for any of your tattoos.
Mm-hmm.
Why?
I'm not a shop tattooist. I've never taken a public appointment. I didn't really have a financial amount that I could put on that intimacy and that trust.
Yeah, machines are pretty abrasive. Mm-hmm. I feel like they drag more.
I love making drawings that are permanent and not in museum archives and not in collectors' houses, but drawings that are lived with and carried around. So, yeah, I just started trading.
What are some of the types of things that you've traded?
Basically everything. I traded for these earrings and I traded for these tattoos and I traded for this dress and I traded for this haircut. I didn't trade for these boots. I spent a lot of fucking money on these boots. Somebody the other day messaged me, was like, I'll trade you for stuff I've dumpster dived for and a 1 hour lesson in Australian politics. And I was like, that is my idea of the worst date of all fucking time.
Now, you've tattooed some pretty amazing people, like Florence Welch from Florence and the Machine.
She gave me a painting and she sang some songs. It was real good.
You got a one-on-one concert with Florence and the Machine.
Well, I tattooed another friend of ours at the time and she was screaming so hard and it was like reverberating through my studio building, so she drowned it out with singing weekend songs at like the top of her voice to cover it up.
And she is a great
vocal range.
Because
no one thought I was like torturing someone in my studio.
A few years ago, you became one of the youngest artists to be featured in the National Gallery of Australia. How did that feel?
I mean, it's incredible, you know, it's and especially as, you know, an immigrant. I didn't go to art school, so yeah, I think it was this kind of really DIY learning.
Your art almost looks like lace or a map out on paper.
Yeah.
What is the inspiration?
I've mapped events or situations in countries that I've lived in or, you know, called home at one point in my life. I collect the data and go back to my studio and basically all the data kind of gets entered into plots on my computer. So they're kind of 3D maps for me. And then I plot it into textiles. So kind of creating these drawings that are just millions of pinholes, one after the other. I think before I started mapping war zones, I was just in Tokyo. It was this really kind of joyful work about, you know, being in my 20s and how much I love my friends. And then Ukraine was invaded. I guess to explain it in an Australian context, it was as surreal as New Zealand invading Australia.
What can you actually remember about your childhood there in Ukraine?
I grew up in the Rogan, which is like the last neighbourhood before the farmhouses start, the really old farmhouses. So in one direction, you just have Soviet concrete blocks, as far as you can see, nine-storey ones, just hundreds and hundreds. And then we were the absolute last one, being from the border where people are bilingual and bicultural and, you know, kind of grow up with this mix of two countries. It's suddenly this complete shock that my mother's city suddenly had missiles that were pointed at my city. I think I suddenly went from mapping Tokyo and this kind of really free, loose kind of life in this endless city to mapping my home that was being invaded and the kind of shock of that.
So you've recently finished what amounts to about 2 years of work with four different installations. What actually links all of those works?
I guess it's this kind of question in my work about how a war zone or a conflict zone changes the land and the actual topography and landscape. I go into a war or conflict zone and I map places where, say maybe like a missile might have hit or in Chernobyl, where radiation levels are different at reactor 4.
You were in Tokyo when one of the world's worst nuclear disasters started unfolding. How did that feel? What was that like?
It was quite terrifying being in Tokyo, like in the years of Fukushima. And I guess I didn't think about it a lot at the time, but being born right after Chernobyl in Ukraine, it was this kind of paranoia, a narrative that I grew up with. I think the really scary thing, and it's so obvious, about nuclear zones is how invisible everything is, you know? And it's almost, it makes it so incredibly surreal.
Some of your designs have ended up on the backs of some of the biggest stars in the world lately. Does that feel bizarre, kind of seeing your design kind of in a paparazzi photo or something on the other side of the world?
A little bit. Everything that I make, whether it's like an artwork or a tattoo, I actually just really love seeing where they end up. You know, it all goes out in the world and it doesn't really belong to you anymore.
Now, Stanislava does only tattoo her mates. Yeah. But after our day together and a few beers, I told her about my dream tattoo, a dinawan or emu footprint in honour of my grandma.
You'd have these kind of showing you the way to something, to like water and things like that, kind of carved into stone.
Yeah.
So they would point towards meeting places or be at meeting places.
So she agreed to give me my first ever tattoo.
Ready? Good girl.
You sound so good.
Nice. Well done. Thank you.